Assalamu alaikum and welcome back to this week's edition of Sisters Corner. With me today, I've got Uzma Kazi, who's an artist, and Uzma's been speaking to me about the various ways in which she uses her artistic skills to debate, discuss, explore current issues. Would that be fair, Uzma?
Yes.
So thank you very much. I hope you've been enjoying your time with us so far.
Yes.
Excellent. So at the beginning of the show, we talked a little bit about, you started to talk about storytelling and how you're trying to bring storytelling and the visual arts together. Could you just tell us a bit more about what nature does this storytelling take, and what have square chapatis got to do with it?
Yes.
Which I'm quite
we'll
interested
get onto
in.
That. storytelling is a really important part for me. I mean, for any theatre maker, storytelling is the heart of what they do.
And before we carry on, could you just explain the difference between fairy tales, like once upon a time reading a book, and storytelling, which is a narrative, a way for people to share their personal stories?
Yeah. Well, I guess, there are these two different types of storytelling. I'm sure there's lots of different types of storytelling,
but
I think the kind of storytelling that I mostly a part of is the latter, which is about offering a space for people to be able to tell their own stories, because I really believe that, you know, we all experience life in different ways. We come from different backgrounds, and we have so much to actually share. But of course, you've got your fairy tales like Alice in Wonderland, which I think are also really important, because we often find hidden metaphors in those kinds of stories, which I think we can apply to our lives or can apply to a situation. So both are very important.
And Islamically, I mean, obviously the hadith of the Prophet is really, really important. We're expected to look at the lessons, you know, from the Prophet and the Sahaba and actually learn from that. And recently I read something, or possibly it was off Facebook, but it was just saying, you know, if you're struggling and you think things are impossible, think of, you know, the prophets and the challenges they went through, and there's lessons in there. So storytelling in that sense is a great, rich tradition. It's part of our Islamic heritage as well.
And I think, you know, I mean, with another collective, I run a monthly space called 10 by 9 Storytelling. So basically 9 people have 10 minutes each to tell a true story of their life.
One day I'm going to come and tell one.
Yes, please do. And it's based on a theme. So the theme coming up for March is decisions. So through this group and through this, you know, it becomes a space to be able to say that thing that you really want to say and really be heard. Listening is a really important part of storytelling. And I think that oral tradition of telling stories is often lost, I think, probably within homes and families to some extent, because, you know, the television takes over or the music and radio is on in the background and so on. And we just have busy and hectic lives, don't we?
Well, one of the things I noticed, I have lots of nieces and nephews, mashallah, but I have 3 who spend quite a bit of time with me. And this weekend, and they're now sort of 13, 11 and 9. So they're a really interesting age where they're starting to explore their understanding of the world a bit, what their personalities are. And it's just starting to come through, and it's really fascinating. We spent 40 minutes, I think, talking about their childhood. So to them, you know, it was just like, and it was funny things we were talking about, them being babies, them being born early, what that meant to us as a family trying to suddenly cope with, you know, really, one of the babies was born 10 weeks early, and what that was like as a family. And I was describing myself as a parent to everyone, including their parents. And it was really interesting because they were fascinated, but they really enjoyed that. And we were talking about each little adventure was like another story, you know, so... And they really loved it because they were so engaged. They were the characters in that story, and that's why they were even more related. And what was fascinating was they'd made up their own stories about what happened and why it happened and their value in that story, which was fascinating for me watching back, because I'm really interested in perception and reality and the way, you know, little people, well, anyone really understands what goes on around them. So it was found. But what was interesting, no screens, nothing, but they really valued that quality bit of a conversation, which I think, like you said, we don't value enough and we don't make enough space for. But you're doing with lots of different people. So which kind of people turn up to these Tengs Nine?
Well, there's a really mixed group of people that come, students. We haven't had many young people, but it is usually on, it's usually on a Friday night. We do it on a Friday night. We have teas, coffees, herbal teas for anyone that's interested in herbal teas. And we have a bit of food on. And we have, there are quite a lot of artistic people who come along. But you know, it's not about being a professional storyteller. It's about reaching within and opening up that, just being able to voice your own story. So, you know, we're all storytellers and that's the approach that we take. It's a very grassroots kind of a thing. So yeah, there's a mixed, really, really mixed. And you know what, it's so interesting because we have one theme, but such diverse stories, really diverse experiences. And I'm really, really intrigued to see what stories we're going to come up with Decision as a theme.
Okay, I think it'll be fascinating actually. Inshallah, if I can, I will pop along. So you use obviously the spoken word to do your storytelling and all the active listening skills, etc. But you're also involved in dialogue work and interfaith work. So what does that look like?
Well, as an artist, freelance artist, it's not always easy to just make your bread and butter on that. So I supplement that with employed work as well. So I've worked with different voluntary sector organisations. So currently I'm working with an organisation called The Feast, which is doing a lot of work around youth work and interfaith work. So it's interfaith dialogue, working with young people. So it's about exploring what makes us similar, but also confronting the differences. So it's not saying, okay, we're always going to, let's just find the similarities and let's be happy with this. It's actually really saying, oh, hang on, there are some things that are different and they can be quite touchy, but let's create a safe space to try and understand each other, because there are so many different, our world is coloured with different people, different backgrounds.
Isn't it more interesting for it?
Yeah.
So basically what you're saying there with the interfaith work is you're bringing people together from different religious backgrounds,
yeah.
And so it is kind of based, people will have a belief, how practicing doesn't matter that much, I suppose. But they will have a belief system that they, you know, adhere to or try to.
Yeah.
And you're bringing young people together. Do you put them all in a room and say, right, talk about what's different? What do you do? Just let them at it? Or
well,
is it a managed process? You know.
Well, it is partly managed. It is partly facilitated because we have something called the guidelines for dialogue. So that's about saying we will create a safe space together. We will acknowledge differences together. There's a really important one. There are many. There's about 11 dialogue rules, guidelines. However, there's one which says we will stop at any moment if we don't feel comfortable to talk about a certain thing. So it's giving young people that option to say, hang on, I will take ownership of this, or hang on, I just don't feel comfortable with that, but I might come back to it at some point. So it's really flexible, but it is youth work and we want to do it in a fun way. You know, we can't be sitting around a table like it's a boardroom. So we have pizza and we have really good fun. We do lots of games. We will go bowling, or we'll go to Laser Quest or something like that. But the dialogue is also really important.
And I suppose, I have a theory what the difference is, but can you tell me what the difference is between dialogue and talking?
But for me, the really important thing in dialogue is the listening, making space to listen and be heard. I think often we can talk and we can respond
to what we think we've heard, to what's in our head.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But whereas dialogue is very much about reflecting, having time to think, being able to respond as opposed to react.
And a big part of it is about saying we need to encourage each other to understand the other person's point of view. We may not agree with it.
Yeah.
And we don't want to necessarily change people's views and force them to think our way, but we need them to understand where we're coming from. And I think, and the other thing with dialogue, it's a two-way process. So, you know, making conscious effort that everyone gets a chance to speak, to check back, etc. It's quite a powerful thing, actually, when, you know, if you do get a chance to be part of these sorts of projects, they are kind of truly quite powerful, aren't they?
Yeah.
So how's it going in Bradford? You've not been doing that interfaith work with the Feast Long here, have you?
Well, it has. I came in on this in November last year, but it has happened before, though it's happened in different ways. So there's me and Ransom, who is a Christian youth worker. So he's sort of focusing a lot in Bradford. I'm focusing in Keighley. So there's some exciting stuff coming up, some really exciting partnerships that we're making. I'm yet to still try and have some more dialogue with parents and with young people themselves. So I'd really like to get out and meet any youth groups, any mosques where youth work is happening or mm-hmm. existing groups are there, schools as well. 11 to 18 is our age range. So if anyone that is watching, you know, get in touch. And
what would be the best way for people to get in touch if they're interested in exploring a partnership with you?
Well, email is the best way. So my Feast email is usma@thefeast.org.uk.
Okay. And there's a website that goes with the Feast, isn't there?
Yeah, so it's www.thefeast.org.uk. Do you remember that then?
Yeah, okay.
But yeah, I mean, you mentioned the Squetch Patty Club as well, and voice and dialogue, and again, that is another space, and it is predominantly a women-only space, and it's about giving women the opportunity to say, hang on, let's reflect on our own lives, let's take ownership, the good things, the really difficult things, the challenges, the achievements, the mm-hmm. time when we've had to really step up and overcome those barriers. You know, we don't give ourselves enough time to acknowledge.
So going back to the beginning of the Square Chapati Club, because I was really disappointed when I realised you don't actually make chapatis and eat them. I was.
Maybe in another version of the project we will.
Yeah. So where did that idea come from? Why the Square Chapati? What's the significance? You know.
For me, it comes from quite a personal space. It's about honouring our own experiences. And as particularly as women, you know, and if you think about it as well, a lot of younger girls, they're almost like some younger girls are trained in how to cook at quite an early age. It's just a thing that you do with your daughters, you know, oh, come on, let's make chapatis together. Or come on, I'll show you how to make such and such. Now, it might start off in quite a really innocent way, but actually that young girl is being set up in a life skill that she's going to perhaps carry on into her married life, you know, mm-hmm. into a different home.
It's not so much the life skill, is it? It's the role.
It's the role.
So,
yeah.
And it's the exclusivity of it. So there's nothing wrong whatsoever with a square chapati or a round chapati. Nothing wrong with learning how to make and cook.
Yeah.
But if then that is all that is expected of this young woman, and if that is all she is allowed to do,
or she's supposed to do.
Or she's supposed to do. It's that burden of expectation and its limitations, isn't it?
You know.
So in our family, we go, well, everyone's got to learn to cook clean and tidy, male or female. I'm not saying everyone does that, and I'm not saying there's complete gender parity, you know, and there isn't actually in society. So I know lots of Muslim women, Asian women will say, oh, well, you know, men don't do this, that and the other. But actually, that's men from all different backgrounds as well. And actually, that's something people need to address. It's just fair, isn't it, to do. If you're all going to live in the same household, try to do as much as you can, support each other. That's just common sense. It's just fairness. But it doesn't happen everywhere. And I'm not even going to pretend and say, there's been research done, hasn't there, that still the vast majority, doesn't matter if both partners are working in really high-powered jobs, still the vast majority of housework is done by women.
Yeah.
So, I mean, there is something that needs to be addressed there.
Yeah.
But, like, I have a couple of sisters who absolutely adore, I know it sounds really bonkers to me, it does sound bonkers to me, but they love creating that home environment. They treasure it, they treasure creating that that safe, warm, environment for their children to flourish, you know. So, and they choose to do that, so that's a really powerful thing.
And it's important that,
but it's not the only thing they're allowed to do, if that makes sense, you know. So that's why I suppose where the square chapati thing comes on, it's the criticism that comes on with not being able to make a nice round chapati.
Yeah, and it is metaphorical because, you know, we've got perfect round rotis that we're expected to make, but life isn't a round roti, you know. Life is a square chapati, and
or a very wonky one.
Yeah. You know, for me, it is a movement. It's not a movement that is about shouting on the streets and saying, "Look, listen to this." It's about honouring your own experiences, taking ownership of your own experiences, and and growing as a person, as a human being. And
and remembering what's important, because even if the chapati's wonky, you can still eat it perfectly well, can't you?
That's it.
Your stomach doesn't care about the shape it started out, does it?
Exactly.
Ultimately. So, but again, we're talking there a bit about judgment as well, because as we know, women in the parents' home, but also, you know, in their husbands' homes, you know, whether they can cook, not cook, how well, you know, whether the rice is fluffy enough, whether it's too hard, too soft, too sticky, all of that, you know, becomes a source of can, and we're talking in generalisations, I know, but can become a source of judgment and ill will, actually, within a household. So actually stepping back and thinking the value of a person is more than what they can cook.
But then
how do you, you know, unpick that and work through that to together?
And we do make, we don't make chapatis that we can eat in the sessions, unfortunately, at the moment, but we do make them as pieces of art. So we are saying, make a square one, make a round one, make a fluffy one, but make one, and don't worry about what shape it is, because no one's watching. But let's sit and let's talk together. Let's listen to each other's and enjoy the process. I think that's so important.
That's something else. I mean, I'm going to have to move us on in a second, right? But I've noticed when I was growing up, and we used to make everything by hand, you know, for Eid. And my mum would make samosas and I would help her and all the different things. It was quite a special time, actually. It was part of the excitement of it all. And now, you know, God rest my mum's old, she's died a long time ago. But it's interesting because I think we're losing that, because everyone just goes to the shop and buys the frozen stuff. So that connectivity, it can be a really positive thing as well. You know, childhood memories, you know. So those memories with my mum will be there and they'll be cherished forever. At the time, maybe I did resent some of it, you know, going, everyone else is gone, mum, why am I still sat with you? But I used to enjoy it, actually, because it was one-to-one time with my mum, and that was quite special. But speaking of breaking the mould... bad pun. Now, anyway, speaking of breaking the mold and doing things differently, on the 26th of January, there was a really interesting event at Bradford College, which was celebrating role models and people who were from the BME communities, from the Muslim community, who are actually doing things differently. So, which is why I was saying, actually, Usmar, I see you as a trailblazer in the artistic world, because it's not something common, and it is harder when there's not people already ahead of you there. So, actually, you'll be a role model for people coming up as well, you know, thinking, yep, I might not be doing a traditional career, but there's something to be made of it. So, we're just going to go to watch this video at the for a few minutes, which is... celebrating the achievements of local BME people in careers you may not have expected. And particularly, this was focusing on Chief Superintendent Mabs Hussain, which is one of the most senior BME officers in the West Yorkshire Police Service force even. So inshallah, we'll see you on the other side of this video.
I've been thinking about the purpose of this event. What is it really about? I personally don't think this is about me. It has to be about something more. An opportunity for those of us who are in positions of trust with a responsibility to others to make a difference within our professions. Not only to the public we serve, but also to the people we lead. I am a proud Bradford lad and a proud British Muslim. Proud of my Pakistani heritage and incredibly proud to be a police officer. My story is no different to many others, I am sure. I never imagined or dreamed I would be stood in this position today, back in 1996, as the district commander for Wakefield. Without the encouragement of my parents and the support from my sisters, I may have never submitted my application form. Reflecting on how I have got here, has brought back a number of feelings and emotions. I have had some fantastic support inside and outside the organisation, from my colleagues, from the staff I have the privilege to lead, and from a number of other organisations who have publicly supported me in the media, such as the Asian Express. Some of the challenges I have had to overcome have been, some have been perceived and some have been very real. A number of people have had a part to play in my success, and it is difficult to mention them all. My commander colleagues, so this is where the participation starts, please raise your hands so other colleagues can see. Scott, don't be shy there. Thank you, Dickie. Thank you, Steve. And Ikram. Ikram plays a very close part. Have shaped for who I am during the last 20 years. A close family friend, Abby, who sat at the front today. My mum used to use him to keep me and my brother in line. He used to pop over and just give us the occasional pep talk.
Committed to this agenda. And whilst we're here and we're celebrating and we want him to go from strength to strength, and clearly I hope we're going to be looking at further promotions in the years to come. Of course, don't want you to leave Wakefield, but I'm sure that you have the talent to go right to the top. We also want to see many, many more Mabs Husseins, and in fact women from Black and minority ethnic communities, reaching every level in West Yorkshire.
Wow, I feel really emotional being up here, especially after seeing Mabs and parents up here. Congratulations, so proud of you, really, really am. The idea for this came about because we were at Oasis College talking to young people about role models, and Ikram approached me and said, Naz, we need to do some celebratory stuff around role models. And the first person he thought of was Mabs. So thank you very much, Ikram. You know, I wanted to bring my son and my daughter, Manisa, here today. And the reason is because the first time I went to West Yorkshire Police, went to Trafalgar House with my kids, Simon Atkin, who's been mentioned before, took my kids around the police station. And ever since then, my boy wants to be a police officer. And this is our chance to get it right, because it needs to be the Aidens and the young people sat here. If they're going to make it to these places, those barriers need to be broken, and it is people like us that are going to break them. So continue, Mabs, may Allah grant you continued success, and mashallah, how proud must you be. Thank you very much, everybody, for tonight.
The public in West Yorkshire. And that, I think, is a fantastic set of values and beliefs that you'd all expect all police officers to have. I can tell you now that Mabs has got those beliefs and those values and those morals and those standards like you wouldn't believe. He's a fantastic role model for West Yorkshire Police. He's a fantastic asset to the police service, and I've no doubt he will go on to other things. We have, Mabs, taken the liberty of sorting out a little award for you. And we were thinking tonight about who should actually present that award, and it certainly shouldn't be me.
Assalamu alaikum, welcome back. What an interesting video we've just been watching there. It was fascinating, wasn't it? What I found really interesting is we had Naz Shah there, who's an MP, you know, local Bradford woman, who's been thrust into the public. Obviously she chose to go into the politics, but some of the nastiness around her campaign was quite hurtful and painful, actually. But then we've also got, you know, Baroness Saeeda Wasi there. So you, as a Muslim woman, you know, who were your role models? Would you have, do you now look at these and think, okay, well, if they can do that, I can? Is that quite a powerful way to help raise aspirations, do you suppose?
I think, you know, like, I feel like generations are really changing. I think the access that Asian women, a lot of women have now, so much more availability and access now compared to what there was maybe even 10 years ago. I think it's really great to see such dynamic women in politics, in maths, in science, in art. Mm-hmm. You know, probably in schools is a good place, I think, especially for young people who are at that crucial age making decisions about what they want to go into. It would be great to see more sort of industry people go into schools on a more conscious level and really share their experiences at work.
Excellent. But I do stand by this, Usma. I do think you're a trailblazer. I think it's really important. It's like, you know, people being able to look up and see other people that look like them, sound like them. You know, like you said, art and engagement in the arts can seem really highbrow, but actually talking about real world applications and how you're using it to address, you know, issues that are important to all people and, you know, help Muslim women, Muslim people just explore where they fit into the world as well, which I think is really powerful. But can you believe it? We are now at the end of our show. So time I told you we could be here for 3 hours. So inshallah, we'll have you back on and we'll explore some more stuff in more detail. In the meantime, could you just repeat your details if people do want to get in touch with you? Where would they?
Yep. So yeah? If you want to get in touch with me about the feast, then you can contact me at www.thefeast.org.uk or you can email me at usma@thefeast.org.uk.
And if anyone's interested in your freelance artistic work,
yep,
can they use the same email or a separate one?
If you email me at creativeresearchuk@gmail.com.
Okay, a woman of many emails. So one way or the other, if you do want to get in touch with Usma, please do. So Usma, thank you very much. It's been a fascinating discussion. And I think a really realistic one about, you know, how art isn't just a very private thing. And actually, there's some controversy sometimes surrounding, you know, artistic expression in the Muslim world. But it is historically part and parcel of our Islamic heritage as well. So if you look at the architecture, you look at the poetry of Rumi, and you look at, you know, the intricate calligraphy and tile work and mosaics. So there's lots of ways to express, you know, and actually go and explore and go and learn more about it, and then do go and support your local artists when they do put on interesting storytelling events, or go to the Square Chapati Club or start your own.
Or start home. Completely start at your own at
Absolutely.
Home.
So inshallah, that is all we've got time for this week. So we'll see you next week. Assalamu alaikum.